Thank you for joining us. We'll be beginning shortly. In the meantime, invite you to open your chat box, set it to all panelists and attendees, and introduce yourself to the group by putting your name and your organization. We'll be beginning shortly. Good morning, and thank you for joining us. We'll be beginning shortly. In the meantime, I invite you to open your chat box, set it to all panelists and attendees, and introduce yourself to the group by putting your name and your organization. We'll be beginning in just a moment. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us. We're going just about to begin. Before I hand it over to Jeff Hayward, I ask you to open your chat box, set it to all panelists and attendees, and introduce yourself to the group by placing your name and the name of your organization. Okay, good morning. I think that we're ready to begin. I'm gonna ask Jeff Hayward, President and CEO of Heart of Florida United Way, to make some opening remarks.
Thank you, Ray, and good morning, everyone. And thank you for joining us for what I think is a very timely start of a conversation about an issue that's gonna be critical to our community. COVID-19 has had some significant economic consequences for our community, as we all know. Businesses have disappeared. Employees have lost their jobs or had their hours cut back. Families are not able to pay their rent or their mortgage or the utilities. Affordable housing was already a big issue in this community and very challenging to many, but we think that problem is about to get much worse. And no one is more worried about that than ALICE. You may know ALICE. ALICE is an acronym that stands for Asset Limited, Income Constrained, Employed. These are families that they're asset limited. They don't have access to credit cards or money in the bank or equity in a home. They're income constrained because many times if they don't work, they don't get paid. They don't have paid time off and things like that. But they're employed. And up until COVID-19, many of them, quite honestly, were working not only one job, but sometimes two or three jobs just to put enough food on the table and keep a roof over their head. ALICE describes about 350,000 households here in Central Florida, just in our Tri-County area. They were living paycheck to paycheck before and are always in danger of falling off a financial cliff. That's about 47% of Central Florida families that were, again, barely able to make ends meet before, and now it's worse. we know that because we hear their voices when they call our 211 information referral line. 211 is a number you can call to find out where to get human and social services, how to get help, whether you're looking for an early care setting for your child or a assisted living place for your mom or dad, you can call 211. And we get a lot of calls each and every day. And the desperation is even more intense now that we're in the middle of COVID-19. You can call, text, or chat 211 24 hours a day, and people do. In fact, in May, just the month of May, we had over 27,000 calls during that month. And 60% of those calls were housing or utility related. So imagine all of those folks calling, looking for help. We also know that when Orange County opened its hotline, they had over 50,000 calls just in that first day. So we know it's a big, big issue. That pre-existing economic fragility that was faced by Alice families has only been exacerbated by COVID-19 and the lack of housing assistance resources. Those are the reasons why we're here today. The state did put in an eviction moratorium, as we all know, and it's in place till July 1. We don't know if it'll be extended, but even if it does get extended, the rent meter is still running. Landlords still rightfully want their rent money. And what we're afraid of is eventually when that moratorium is lifted, whether it's July 1 or some date in the future, we're going to be facing a tidal wave of evictions and foreclosures. The purpose of coming together today is to highlight that inevitable problem that our community is going to face, particularly if we don't address it. And that big issue is homelessness. All of these families will need a place to go. They will lose their apartments, and then our community will begin facing an even more deep and entrenched problem. Today, we're going to hear from local experts. They're at the center of the eviction process by virtue of the position they hold in our community. We want to learn today. We want to educate ourselves on the eviction process. We want to make everyone aware of what is available to families, but also to begin to think of new ideas and better strategies. Now, I'm not naive. I recognize there are no easy answers how to solve this problem, and there's no easy solutions with resources that are currently available. In fact, there aren't enough resources, and that's part of the biggest problem. So again, we can't simply sit back, though, and accept that as the inevitability, because inaction is not going to be our best answer, our best solution. We need to sound the alarm, bring players together, begin a conversation, create partnerships, and as funders, figure out how we can collaborate towards a solution and explore creative approaches and best practices that are being used in other communities throughout the United States. So you all see the value in coming together, otherwise you wouldn't be here this morning. I want to thank you and express our gratitude for all of you to come to the table and try and find a solution for these struggling families. And I want to thank our panelists for participating and taking their time out and again, rolling up their sleeves and helping us to find a solution. I'm going to turn it over to Ray Larson so we can begin the questions and the panel discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff, very much. And I want to add my word of welcome to everyone. We appreciate you being here for this important conversation. We have a very distinguished panel, which I'm going to introduce in just a moment, but wanted to just cover a couple of housekeeping type of issues as we go forward. One is I want to make everyone aware that this webinar is being recorded. Secondly, all participants are muted. As you can see in the participant box, we have many people with us. And so to control that background noise that we sometimes find in these virtual convenings, and to make sure that you can hear our panelists clearly, all our attendees will be on mute during the course of the conversation. You have at the bottom of your screen two options. One is labeled chat. Many of you have already placed your names and the name of your organizations there. That chat feature is there for you to share resources, to introduce yourself and your organization, and like I say, share resources and thoughts with one another. The second option you have is Q&A. We hope to have some time for some questions for the panelists at the end of our conversation. That's where you would submit those, in the Q&A. So if you have a specific question for the panelists, please enter it on the Q&A aspect. If you're sharing with the entire group, use the chat feature. Now I'd like to introduce our very distinguished panel who's going to help us with this conversation today. We have two members of the Ninth Circuit Court of Florida with us today, Chief Judge Donald Myers and Orange County Clerk of the Courts Tiffany Moore Russell. Judge Myers has served as circuit judge since 2011, handling cases ranging from the Unified Family Court in Osceola County to Felony Criminal Court in Orange County. He also served as one of two judges in the Complex Business Division Court. He was elected as Chief Judge of the Ninth Judicial Circuit of Florida in 2019. Welcome, Judge, and we're glad that you're with us.
Thank you. Thanks for the chance to be here.
Tiffany Moore Russell has served her community as an Orange County Commissioner from 2006 to 2014, and now serves as Orange County Clerk of the Courts. Trained as an attorney, she understands that access to the justice system is crucial, especially for those in the community who are economically challenged. Another representative of Orange County is Sheriff John Mina. Sheriff John Mina has dedicated his life to public safety. He spent nearly 28 years with the Orlando Police Department, where he rose through the ranks and was appointed Chief of Police in 2014. For more than 4 years, he commanded 1,000 sworn and civilian Orlando Police Department personnel and 100 volunteers. Since 2018, he has been serving as Orange County Sheriff and is also acting as board member of the Heart of Florida United Way. Could I just ask a member of our staff, my screen has changed. Can you all hear me?
Yes, Ray.
Clerk, I can hear you, Ray.
Okay, thank you. My screen has gone blank, as long as you can hear me. We are also very fortunate to have two organizations, representatives of organizations here to speak specifically of the resources available to the community. Jay Mobley has worked as a housing and consumer attorney with the Legal Aid Society for the past 7 years, where he manages the Legal Aid Society's homeless advocacy and outreach project, which provides on-site legal clinics for the homeless population here in Central Florida. He serves on the executive board for Heart of Florida United Way's Mission United, and is also chair of Mission United's legal committee. Welcome, Jay. And finally, Jerika Mobley is a staff attorney for Community Legal Services of Mid-Florida and represents low-income clients in various housing-related matters. She has been recognized for her advocacy work and accomplishments and is an active member of Orange County's Community Action Board. Again, a very distinguished panel, and welcome to our panel. So now I'd like to get started with our conversation. As Jeff mentioned in his preliminary remarks, the reason that we're gathering today is that we fear that we're facing a tidal wave of evictions once the moratorium on evictions expires. Chief Judge Myers, I'd like to turn it over to you and ask, should we be expecting that tidal wave? And what's the perspective from that you have, and what might we be expecting?
Thank you, Mr. Larson. Thank you again for the privilege of being able to speak with this group about what I know is a very important issue in our community. I am honored to represent all of the judges of the Ninth Judicial Circuit, but in this conversation in particular, we're addressing the issues that are raised before our county court judges. The jurisdiction to handle eviction claims is founded in the Constitution and in the statutes, and is given to our county court judges to address. And so this tsunami or tidal wave, as you have called it, is headed directly for our county court judges. We have 22 of those county court judges in the circuit and about six of them, I think, total, that currently handle landlord-tenant disputes in the county court, including residential evictions. And I think it is absolutely clear that that's the direction that we're headed. We use March the 17th as the marker for us, or the beginning of this time of the pandemic, because that's when we began to first receive some guidance from the Florida Supreme Court on our court operations. And it would be I think it's critical for us as we talk about this issue of evictions to look at them in the context of what the orders are that we've received from the Supreme Court and then thereafter from the governor with respect to the moratorium. The Supreme Court is the entity that guides and gives us direction for the local court operations in the trial courts. And here in the Ninth Circuit in Orange and Osceola County, when the Supreme Court first came out with direction, it was essentially to contract back on all of the services that the courts were providing. And it immediately had an impact because it prescribed or limited us from handling any sort of in-person court work. And many evictions ultimately result in some in-person type hearings. Many don't. Many are handled directly on papers or pleadings. But what the Supreme Court directed us to do was to focus our energies and efforts in that March 17 timeframe on doing what the Supreme Court defined as essential court services. And eviction proceedings did not fall into that area of essential court proceedings. Instead, we were focused on due process rights of people who were being impacted by the pandemic. Just as an example, folks who get arrested have a right to see a judge within 24 hours of arrest. We were focused on developing processes and procedures to do those types of due process proceedings in a safe and efficient manner to ensure that those constitutional rights were being protected. The result of that was it diverted our attentions away from many of those things that the courts ordinarily are undertaking in any given day in the courthouse. I had our folks pull some numbers that I thought might be helpful to begin to understand the magnitude of what we're looking at when we come down this road. But in the three-month period, March 17 to June 17 of 2019, there were over 2,300 residential eviction cases filed in Orange County. In that same time period in 2020, we've seen less than 300. And those 300, I suspect, were filed before the governor put into place the moratorium with respect to the filing of residential evictions. So we know that the best of times, and I think we would all say that the economy was humming along in early 2019, we saw about 2,300. We've only seen less than 300. So there's at least another 2,000 that have stacked up that we would have seen in just the best of times. But because of the far-reaching impact of the pandemic, its impact on our local community, on jobs, employment, savings, ability to make PIP bills, the prioritization, the challenges that folks have had, we think that's probably the tip of the iceberg. I think if I were to forecast, I think we're looking at numbers that are many multiples of that 2,000 cases that are likely to come to the courts when the moratorium is ultimately lifted by the governor. It's interesting, and it's a fine nuance, but our lawyers that are a part of this call will appreciate this. I received many communications when this all started. Judge, why don't you stop evictions? Stop this process from happening. The governor hasn't done anything. Why don't you do that? We in the courts understand and believe in the separation of powers, and the ability to stop the effect of a statute is not something that falls in the purview of the local trial court or even the Florida Supreme Court. That ultimately is something that is only within the governor's authority, and particularly during the time of an emergency condition. And so it was his order that came down on April the 2nd with the first 45-day moratorium that really created this window of time where we have not been handling any foreclosures. And then of course the subsequent extensions that are associated with that. Evictions will not be the same when we come out of all of this. There are a number of complicating factors that have been added to this process by virtue of federal legislation in the CARES Act and certain defenses to foreclosure cases that are related to the COVID virus. There will be issues related to the suspension of the statute and what that means. The governor chose some interesting language as a means of putting the brakes on foreclosure or foreclosures and eviction processes. We anticipate that there will be a great deal more litigation surrounding these cases than there has been previously. And I know I've heard reference to this even in some of our earlier chat about the foreclosure system, and I'm guessing somebody will have a chance to talk about the laws that relates to this. We are a pay-to-play state, generally, that you have to, if you want to challenge an eviction action, you have to pay rent into the registry of the court. Otherwise, you, in essence, lose. There's very few ways around the failure to have paid that rent in. But I think now that we're going to have some issues that will be litigated in these eviction cases. So I envision that we will see many more and that they will be much more complex when we're headed out of this.
Thank you, Judge. That certainly adds gravity to our conversation, recognizing that we might indeed expect this tidal wave and that it's even more complicated than ever before. Clerk Moore Russell, your office obviously is central to this process. Wanted to ask you what you're seeing. Are you seeing increased activity, expecting increased activity? What's the perspective that you have?
Thank you, Ray. And just to add some context to the looking at what should we expect, I also want to share that the summer months for when we look at the history of evictions in our circuit or Orange County specific, July to October was always a high peak time period for evictions pre-COVID anyway. And so unfortunately, we are also entering into what we consider a high peak season. And so, you know, we're expecting, you know, normally, you know, around July and between July and October, we'd get over 1,000, you know, a month of filings. So you can just imagine what that's going to be when the moratorium is lifted, because during this time, and a lot of that could be due to, from a college perspective, people are leaving school, but it's a seasonal thing that we're seeing when it comes to forecasting and looking at the cycles per month. So we're expecting to see a large volume in our civil filing for evictions.
Thank you. That certainly adds more context. For our attendees, I just want to remind you that you have the chat box to share resources with one another, and the Q&A box to address specific questions to the panelists. We hope to get to those questions towards the end of our presentation. Jay, I'd like to go to you. Probably a fair number of people that have joined us this morning might be familiar with the eviction process, but for many of us, we're not. I was hoping maybe you could give us an overview of that eviction process and what happens during that process.
Sure, I'd be glad to do that. Basically, the eviction process, I'm going to talk specifically about non-payment cases because that's mostly what we're dealing with here. It would start by the tenant being late on rent. The landlord would then, as required by statute, serve them with a 3-day notice to pay rent. That is the first step in an eviction action. It gives them 3 days, excluding holidays and weekends, to make good on the rent, to pay that rent. If they are able to do that within the 3 days, the matter gets kind of quashed right there and goes away. If not, that gives the landlord the right to go down to the clerk's office and file the eviction action. Once the eviction action is filed, the service will go out through either the sheriff or a private process server. Once the tenant is served, they have 5 days in which to write an answer and file that with the clerk of court. And that's where the pay-to-play system that the judge was talking about comes in. They have that 5-day period, excluding holidays and weekends, to post all of the alleged rent due into the court registry. If they aren't able to post into the court registry, they just don't have the money, and I think most of the people we're talking about are in that situation, then what happens is the clerk is going to enter a default because they didn't comply with filing an answer and paying the rent. That default then goes to the judge, and the judges are able to issue a 24-hour writ of possession that would come out the sheriff would serve or post it on the door. And then 24 hours later, they are able to remove the tenant and the landlord can change the locks on the unit. So that whole process can take less than 2 weeks in many cases if they don't have the money to put into the registry. There are a couple of little things the judge alluded to. You can file what's called a motion to determine rents if there is a disputed amount in the rent that's owed. If, say, your lease says $800 a month and the landlord on the eviction action claims you owe $1,000 a month, then that's a questionable issue that you can file a motion to determine rent. It will trigger a hearing. The judge will determine how much you have to post into the registry and give you a time frame to do that. And if you're able to post it within that time frame, then you would, you know, move forward through the court process of having a hearing on the eviction or perhaps go to mediation on it. But the process, usually within 10 days, a tenant could be out if they don't have the money to pay. So it's a pretty harsh, fast system. And that's what I expect from a lot of the cases that are filed, is they will result in defaults for inability to pay the rent. That's what we're facing.
Thank you, Jay. You know, not being involved in this work every day, I didn't know the process and didn't realize the time frame that it occurs in. I just want to alert our panelists. I'm having technical difficulty and cannot see you. So we certainly want dialogue. So whenever you have a point or want to add, please just speak up as you go forward. Sheriff, I wanted to come to you. You know, as it became clear that we were facing a pandemic, you took a pretty strong stance right away. Wanted to ask you, why did you take that stance in regard to those writs of possession? What drove that decision? And can you give us any insight into the Sheriff's Association's perspective and what the sentiment might be there?
Well, thanks, Ray, and a big thanks to Jeff Hayward and Heart of Florida United Way for having this very important discussion. So as we entered into the pandemic and you're watching all the footage of people getting laid off and being forced to go on furlough, you know, this is my community too, that hit home. But at the same time, I did have several state representatives contact me and kind of direct me to some articles and news coverage of things they were doing in Miami and how they had halted evictions in South Florida because of COVID. So I did contact them, and then I also immediately got in touch with Chief Judge Myers, and I told him where my concerns were, number one being a part of this community, but on top of that, I didn't want my deputies unnecessarily exposed to the pandemic. And at that point, we weren't sure, you know, what the exposure rate would be. And so we were really only responding to, you know, emergency type calls and calls that we had to answer right away. We had shut down, you know, operations at the sheriff's office. We were, you know, asking people to call in with reports when they could. So, you know, we wanted to, you know, help stop the spread, number one, to, you know, our deputies, and because since they're out in the public, they could continue to spread the virus that happened. And number two, I didn't want our deputies and law enforcement to be vilified in the midst of this pandemic with people losing their jobs and being forced to go on furlough, to be the ones to force people out of their homes in, you know, in this state of emergency. So, you know, Chief Judge Myers totally understood, and you know, about that time within that same week, and I said that, you know, I didn't feel comfortable with you know, having my deputies serve the evictions. The governor came down with his order. And so as far as the Florida sheriffs, there's differing opinions, and, you know, I did have a couple of them call me and say, hey, wait a minute, the sheriff can't unilaterally, you know, just decide not to do evictions. And I said, yeah, I understand. And that's why, you know, I worked with our chief judge. And again, you know, shortly after that, the governor, you know, came down with his executive order. And so, you know, the sheriffs are of the opinion that if the court order is issued by a judge, they're going to go ahead and follow through with that court order. And so that's why, I mean, the importance of this discussion. You know, if it does not get extended, I would imagine that sheriffs across the state will continue to serve evictions. So I have 13 deputies and supervisors that are part of our eviction unit. We currently are in possession of over 160 evictions that need to be served. There are a number of them that were pre-pandemic that we're still holding on to. So, you know, it's a critical time waiting on, you know, direction from the governor and to see if it will be extended. But certainly, you know, we will follow the court orders that are issued to us, but we don't want to have to be put in that position of kicking out people to our homes. I also, when this happened, I did reach out to our apartment associations that represent our landlords, and they were very gracious, I will say. That they understood the needs of the community, but also are trying to look out for the livelihood and the well-being of their landlords as well. And I thought they were very gracious and understanding and just wanted to know what the process was and what was behind those decisions that we made.
Thank you, Sheriff. You know, we've been living, you know, through extraordinary times, and now we face this wave of eviction. So I know that that's a lot for our community and certainly for the sheriff's office to deal with as well. Wanted to ask a couple of general questions to the panel. And my first, it really piggybacks on where you ended, Sheriff. The perspective of the landlord. We'll certainly, in a short while, talk a little bit about resources or what might be available for tenants who find themselves in a situation. But the dynamic of landlords in this, I think, is an important, you know, part of the equation, obviously, that, you know, not collecting rent, what happens when they can't pay their bills? So I wanted to just put that to the panel. What do you think your perspective in regard to the landlords, where they're at, and what might be some of the shorter and longer term consequences if landlords aren't able to collect their rent or their mortgages?
Ray?
Please.
I will say, just as tenants are panicking about not-
Derek, if I could just ask you to speak up a little bit louder, you're a little bit soft, at least for me.
Okay, let me lower the volume a bit. Is that better?
Thank you.
Well, I'll say, just as tenants are panicking about not paying their rent, certain landlords are in a similar position as it relates to their mortgage. You know, your corporate landlords who own multiple apartment complexes, they usually have the cash or the access to credit to cover costs when rents aren't paid. However, your mom and pop landlords, you know, they usually don't have the same access to capital. So they rely heavily on rent payments to cover their expenses. So in my opinion, you know, the small landlords have been hit harder by COVID-19 and they've had, you know, they've been forced to think of alternative ways to make ends meet.
And Ray, I'll tell you, I've heard from some of those landlords who are very upset that the courts are not proceeding or moving forward with evictions. And indeed, one of them has actually filed a petition in the Fifth District Court of Appeals, asking the court to declare the governor's moratorium order, as well as my local administrative order, unconstitutional as a taking, in essence, of the landlord's property rights, the right to receive income. That's pending. I don't know whether there'll be any action on it anytime soon. The moratorium may end before that ever gets resolved.
Also, one thing I would mention, the mom and pops, they are under pressure, and we have seen a spike here in self-help evictions since this moratorium was put in place. More of the bad actors, not necessarily your good landlords, but we've had more bad actors removing doors, shutting off utilities, making a lot of threats and, you know, otherwise helping themselves, which is against the Florida statutes. And we've had to actually take a couple of those cases to court. But there is definitely pressure on both sides here.
And Ray, if I can just add another element, is that those small mom and pop landlords who may own their residential home and maybe have one or two rental properties, if they're not able to pay those mortgage payments, that may then turn into a foreclosure for them. So there's a different civil action. So there is a ripple effect that's impacting multiple parties.
Yes, thank you. I think it's important that we keep that perspective that there's many people involved in this and impacted by this. And Jay, I think I hear you that, you know, there are landlords that are following the rules, are following the process, but there are some that have taken matters into their own hand. And I wonder if tenants know their rights, you know, in that situation, or if there are things that might cause them to be afraid to, you know, to stand up for those rights.
You know, I find that most tenants are not fully aware of their rights. Most tenants, it depends on whether they've been through an eviction action before, they have any education, you know, personal experience with an eviction. Most of the times they don't know their rights, or they assume they have more rights than they really do in Florida. Florida is not known to be a tenant favorable state when it comes to things like this. And landlords, some of them, they know the rights. Some of them know the actions they're taking for self-help evictions are against the law, but they still do them anyway. And I mean, there's stiff penalties for self-help evictions. If it's proven, the tenant can get 3 times the monthly rent, you know, or actual damages, and even moving expenses. So, you know, there's teeth there, but some of these landlords, they either feel the pressure or they, you know, I don't want to lump them all into one group. Some of them are good. You know, they try to treat the tenant correctly, but there are those bad actors out there. And a lot of those, unfortunately, are bad actors in normal times. So the pressure here just makes it even worse.
There is some relief. There is some relief for these landlords under the Federal CARES Act. You know, landlords who have a federally backed mortgage, they can request a 180-day mortgage forbearance. There's even an option for 180 more days, provided that the extension is requested, while we're still dealing with this pandemic.
Thank you for that. You know, that remark and talking about the process and the judge's opening remarks, it seems like this is, and in fact, the judge said it, this is going to be even more difficult than usual, because there's all these other provisions connected to COVID and what's going on. I think it's going to probably make it harder for everyone, and certainly for tenants and landlords as they try to navigate that, and for those that are trying to follow the process, to be able to follow that process and take advantage of what's been coming through the legislation and the like. Just a reminder, I'm sorry, panelists, again, I have a technical difficulty and can't see you. So please, if you have a comment, just speak up, because I won't be able to see you raising your hand or anything like that. And for our participants, just a reminder, please share resources with one another in the chat box. We will have some time for questions towards the end. So if you have a question for the panel, please go to the Q&A feature and put your question for the panel there. So we only have a little bit of time for a couple more questions before we get to that Q&A, but I did want to talk a little bit about resources in the community. And I would be remiss, I'm with the Heart of Florida United Way, and of course, we have the 211 Center. And just to remind everyone that anybody in the community, by dialing 211 or texting their zip code to 898-211, can be connected with a 211 specialist who will work to connect them to the best resources that may be available for the situations that they're facing. So I wanted to talk more about the resources, and I thought, Sheriff, if I could go to you, you know, I guess I hadn't thought as much about the experience of deputies going to deliver these writs, and wondered if there's often much dialogue between the deputy and the person that the writ's being delivered to, and do the deputies have any resources that they're able to give to tenants to help them?
Yeah, so there is dialogue, of course. It can be very hard on the tenants. We understand that. So our job is to remain impartial to both parties during the civil process, and our job is to serve and enforce the orders enacted by the courts. But there are remedies that are out there, resources. Certainly, we do let them know about Hard Florida EIOA and 211, and also, and you know, maybe the clerk can talk more about that. We do direct them to that self-help center at the clerk of the courts as well. And you know, our deputies are human. You know, they try and remain as impartial as possible, but they realize it's tough on all parties, and especially the person who is getting evicted. So they try and treat those folks with compassion while still doing their job, and try and point them to those resources that we have in our community. But you know, as you can imagine, it can be a sense of frustration for someone getting evicted.
Clerk Moore Russell, do tenants contact your office looking for help, and how do you direct them?
So typically, tenants will contact the clerk's self-help center if they've received some type of three-day notice or they've received an eviction complaint. The self-help center has been open now for about 5 years, and primarily, now what's interesting is that we're not tied to income. So it's not based on their income. They don't have to fall within a certain category. And we don't limit it to just tenant. It's any party. So we've had some mom-pop landlords that have come and asked for legal advice because we've partnered with the Orange County Bar Association. So we are open, and it's really there to ask questions, help them navigate as a pro se litigant through the forms and how to navigate the process of filing for an eviction or defending an eviction action. And so during the COVID, we've recently transitioned with the Orange County Bar Attorneys, where now those legal meetings are via Zoom, where prior to the COVID, they would come into the courthouse and meet face-to-face. So we have worked out with the bar where those attorneys can interact with that customer via Zoom. But you do lose that personal touch because people like to show you their paperwork. They like to ask questions. But in this environment right now, and due to limited access to the building, we're just going to have to use technology. But, you know, they can make those appointments with the self-help center on our website, which is myorangeclerk.com. But we are up and running with attorneys with the Orange County Bar Association, helping those who have questions about their landlord-tenant matter.
Thank you. I wanted to go to our agency representatives, and Jerika, I wanted to start with you, and I, again, just ask you maybe to move a little closer to your mic and speak a little bit louder. What resources or what advice do you give to tenants that you work with?
Generally, during the course of representing a client, I provide him or her with a list of community resources. It's a 9-page list of local social services organizations who provide mortgage and rental assistance, utility assistance, assistance with food and transportation, and even job training assistance.
Thank you. And Jay, anything that you wanted to add to that?
We do the same. I refer a lot of people to 211. So we have a list as well, and then we hand that out to folks that are coming in that are facing eviction. Unfortunately, as you know, things are stretched really thin right now as far as the available resources.
Yeah, thank you. I want to make sure that we have time for question and answer. So I wanted to ask this last question to the entire panel. Looking longer term, maybe midterm to longer term, are there any great programs, innovations that are happening elsewhere in the state or in the country that our community should be looking at that can help with this situation?
Well, I will say in my current position, I exclusively represent tenants, but unfortunately Florida, as Jay and Judge Myers have mentioned, is not the most tenant friendly state. So right now, irrespective of the merits of a landlord's case, at some point, the already financially strapped tenant will be required to deposit rent into the court's registry or risk the landlord winning the eviction by default. So the ease in which landlords can win by default has created somewhat of a processing plant for evictions. So I would like to see added restraints on landlords to slow down the eviction process, and that's coming from a tenant's advocate, mind you. So I would like to see these restraints. For example, you know, in DC, Vermont, Wisconsin, Minnesota, Massachusetts, and Tennessee, tenants are given 30 to 14 days to pay past due rent before an eviction may be filed, compared to only 3 days in Florida. Additionally, I'm not sure if this is being practiced in other jurisdictions. However, I do believe that courts should be required to deny a residential eviction if the tenant has otherwise been in good standing with the landlord and pays all past due rent and court costs. Currently, tenants can still be evicted even if they timely deposit the past due rent into the court's registry. And I just don't think that's fair.
I would piggyback on that. It's really hard when I'm giving a consult, someone who has the eviction pending and they're, you know, on day four of their or filing period, and they've begged, borrowed, and scraped together the money, and they're asking me, what do I do with this money? Do I pay it? What's going to happen if I pay it? And while I explain, you're going to get your court process then, but you could end up being evicted anyway. So I tell them, it's like going to Vegas. Which one are you going to bet on? Are you going to bet that you can beat the landlord? Because, you know, in Florida, being late on your rent is grounds for termination of that lease. So you could ultimately pay all of your money, make the landlord happy, and then you're out on the street with no money and no resources. So quite often I have to advise people, you know, let it go through a default and use that money to secure housing somewhere else.
Terrible decision to have to make.
One more thing that is kind of, we haven't talked about it. All of these folks are going to have an eviction filed against them. That is a black mark on their record. In the state of Florida, it's going to follow them forever. It can't be sealed or expunged because it's considered a public record. So this first wave of evictions, even if we get past that, rehousing these people is going to be an issue because now they have an eviction and they have to get through that hurdle with a new landlord. So that's an added wrinkle in you know, what we're throwing at these folks.
So, you know, unfortunately, our time is drawing to a close. I want to make sure that we have a chance for some questions. Clearly, a lot of complications, a lot of things for us to be thinking about. Rosanna, I wanted to ask you, are there any questions that we can pose to the panel from our participants?
Yes, actually, Ray, I do have one question. Have there been any conversations or considerations regarding virtual court/eviction hearings taking place and the likelihood that default judgment is more likely because individuals may not have internet access on the assumption that if persons cannot pay the rent, they probably cannot pay internet bills either?
Ray, I'll take that one. That's a great question. You know, as we move through the pandemic in the court system, we have moved very heavily to virtual appearances for all sorts of court hearings. And I can imagine a time when we move to having to address some of these eviction cases utilizing remote technology. But we are very conscious of the digital divide, the fact that many people simply don't have the resources to be able to video conference in for a hearing. And some folks don't even have the capability of calling in for a hearing on a telephone. These are folks who have inexpensive phones. They're purchasing minutes and trying to utilize those well for their future. And so we have provided, in some space we have downstairs in the courthouse, internet access rooms so that litigants can come here to the courthouse. They're welcome to come in to the first floor offices, and we have video connections set up for them so that they can actively participate in whatever court proceedings may be going on that they may not have access to. So we do have that proviso or provision for folks to be able to continue to access the courts even in this time of pandemic or because of financial difficulty. But I will also say our judges will not take action on a case when somebody is unable to participate in a hearing that they have a right to participate in. And so if something occurs where notice is given and someone communicates that they're unable to participate because of financial circumstances, they may not have the bus money, candidly, to get here to the courthouse. And again, those are practical issues that we have to take into account. We will facilitate that in some form or fashion. Nationwide, there's a conversation about these types of issues, and the National Center for State Courts is actually negotiating with mobile carriers to provide internet access and minutes for court hearings and circumstances just like this on a pro bono, here's free minutes for you to be able to access the courts. And we're excited about the prospect of that as well.
Okay, thank you. Unfortunately, the time has gone way too quickly on this. Before I thank the panel, I just want to ask the panel, like I said, our time is very brief. Any final comments any of the panelists would like to make?
Ray, I would just say that, we're all part of this community. Our deputies are part of this community. The last thing that we want to have to do is force people, into the streets and to become homeless because of what happened with the pandemic. But we also understand they're all the landlords, and certainly those the smaller mom and pop types are in need of income too as well. It's a very difficult and complex issue, and I'm glad we have folks like the Heart of Florida United Way that could help us guide our community through this.
Ray, I just want to thank you for including me, and just want to share with those who are listening that the clerk's office is planning a virtual legal forum on evictions, depending on just trying to prepare the community, maybe including both the Mobleys, who usually work really well with the legal services and legal aid. We have our face-to-face forums, but this will be virtual, but to really dive into more detail the entire process, help people answer questions, how to navigate it when they're facing that situation. So that will be coming in July.
Thank you, Clerk Morrisel.
I will say that a tenant's access to legal counsel significantly increases their chance of saving their housing. So as soon as, they're served with an eviction summons and complaint, it's best to try to contact Community Legal Services or the Orange County Bar Association to get some help.
I would echo that. We are working with like half a staff, so we're working remotely still, but we are at full capacity as far as answering the phones and doing intake over the phones, providing consults, video and telephone. So please refer people that need help with evictions to legal aid. Also, this has brought up other issues such as family law issues, domestic violence issues. We're ready to help with those as well. So please feel free to reach out.
Thank you, Jay.
And Ray and Jeff, thank you again for the opportunity on the courts. Appreciate the opportunity to be a part of this community and to talk about important issues like this.
Thank you, Judge. I know you won't be able to see them and won't be able to hear them clapping, but everyone wants to thank our panelists, Chief Judge Donald Myers, Orange County Clerk of the Courts, Tiffany Moore Russell, Sheriff John Mina, Jay Mobley, and Jerika Mobley. Thank you very much for this very important conversation, and I'm gonna throw it back to Jeff for some final comments.
Thank you, Ray, and thank you to our panelists, Judge, the Sheriff, the Clerk, and our two expert attorneys. We were hoping that this is what we would be able to accomplish today, at least a discussion to raise awareness, to call out and ring the alarm that this is an oncoming, tidal wave that will hit our community. It's only a start. And I think I said that in the beginning that we're not going to solve anything today, but again, we want to raise awareness and begin the discussion. I did hear a call to action today from several of our speakers, and that is working with our state and local jurisdictions and the courts, looking at data and what the trends are and so forth, ensuring that people know perhaps what the CARES Act can do for them, for both the tenant side and the landlord side, exploring some innovative programs. Jerika had mentioned some other states using some innovative programs like an eviction diversion program or something like that. Look to funding from our funders around individual assistance programs and the like. So I did hear a call to action, and I'm hoping that this will not be the last conversation. As the clerk said, there will be holding more discussions in July, and we hope to continue these as well. I want to extend my personal gratitude and thanks to our panelists. I personally learned a lot today, and I thought I had already known a little bit about this, but this has been very enlightening for me, and I'm sure everyone who attended also learned something else as well. And I want to thank you all for your dedication. As the sheriff said, you know, this is his community. This is our community. You all live here. Yes, you have a job. Yes, you have to follow the law. You've got to adhere to the Constitution and our laws of the state of Florida. But there is a human aspect to this, and each and every one of you know that. And I do appreciate that and understanding that we all have to live here in this community together. We'll be posting a blog recap of this meeting on our website, hfuw.org. You saw in the chat the resources if you need help to go to our website, hfuw.org/get help. And there you can access 211. As Ray mentioned, you can call 211. You can text your zip code to 898-211 and engage a call specialist right away. Again, we want to give everyone in this community the opportunity to succeed, and we want to make sure that we as a community don't accept inaction as our response to this oncoming challenge in our community. Again, thank you all, and please be safe.
Thank you, Jeff.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jeff.
Sheriff, thank you.
No problem. Thanks.
Appreciate it.
Take care.